So, let's continue our discussion of Gnostic teaching, and we'll be working our way slowly to the Gospel of Thomas. I'm actually finding so much interesting material that provides intellectual context, historical, and even sociological context to the Gospel of Thomas that I'd like to continue along with it. So our first discussion in the last few weeks has been Marcion of Sinope, and basing, we're really focusing on the implications of basic teachings. And therefore, I don't think there's a problem staying with or being based in Wikipedia. For all its faults, Wikipedia in some topics I think is very helpful. And everything that's being said here is introductory. But there's a lot to say, and we can go quite deep actually. So, when we're trying to look at the context of the Gospel of Thomas, which was discovered with the Nag Hammadi Library, we find that ultimately it was associated with other Gnostics of the first 3 centuries. And if we trace and examine teachings and then trace back to their teachers, we find some interesting things. And we'll see some perspective, some basic context of the philosophical view of the writer or writers of the Gospel of Thomas. So Marcion is dated basically 85 to 160 AD, after the, I guess, what, the temple, the fall of the Second Temple, and after 70 AD, and certainly beyond the death or the passing of Yeshua. And we go to this idea that his theology, and this is a very critical kind of Gnostic perspective, Marcion's theology rejected the deity described in the Hebrew scriptures, and in distinction affirmed the Father of Christ as the true God. Meaning, the Gnostic perspective that's very common is the Father Yeshua, the Father Yeshua was discussing or presenting, is not Yahweh. And there you get to, then you go to the particular Gnostic view of the Demiurge and the Archons, which really is no different, frankly, than Ra's presentation of 4D negative Orion leadership and multiple levels of non-physical astral, lower astral, negatively oriented entities and black magicians on the astral plane, which is 3D space time space. So the Archons, I mean, it's very simple if you have a better key than vague translations of 2,000-year-old documents. The raw material answers all these questions in a very, very systematic metaphysics. The Demiurge is Yahweh. Ra explains that Yahweh is Orion, the false Yahweh, actually, that co-opted the contact with Moses 3,500 years ago. And the workers of Orion, 4D negative entities, and astral plane negatively oriented entities, which can be called demons, which include hell beings and black magicians and all sorts of negative entities in the lower astral, are the Archons. That's very simple. And so, yeah, there's a negative path, and the Gnostics understood it. And the Christian Church Fathers it was a very important matter, it seems, for the Church Fathers, that Christianity or the authoritative gospels and doctrine of the evolving, emerging church had the perspective that the Father Yeshua was referring to was the same as Yahweh of the Old Testament. Now, is that Jewish influence in the first 3 or 4 centuries? in formation of Christian doctrine? Yeah, maybe it is. And so the church fathers denounced Marcion. He chose to separate himself from the proto-Orthodox church. He had a sort of view of, we look down the page a little further, his teachings, dietheism, dietheistic system. He concluded that many of the teachings of Jesus were incompatible with the actions of Yahweh, God of the Hebrew Bible, again understood by Ra as Yahweh or a false, the false as Orion or the false Yahweh. So it's perfectly that Gnostic notion of a negatively oriented false creator God being Demiurge fits perfectly with Ra's understanding of Orion co-opting the contact with Moses. And then this is a very Gnostic notion of two gods, a higher transcendent one and a lower world creator and ruler. And Yeshua talked about powers and principalities. He didn't, Marcion again, didn't claim the Jewish scriptures were false, but he asserted they're not to be read in an absolutely literal manner, developing the understanding that Yahweh was not the same God spoken of by Jesus. Perfectly in line with the raw material. And that's when you get to this notion of the Demiurge, the God of the Old Testament, creator of the material universe, which doesn't fit Ra. Ra doesn't say that Orion created the material universe. But Ra would say that Orion has significant influence over the affairs of 3D space-time. And interestingly, his perspective on the law of the Demiurge, or the false god of the Old Testament, or the tribal god of the Jews of the Old Testament, was that law of that false god or Demiurge, false creator god. You know, God can be higher dimensional being. God can be creator of light. The one God, the source, is the creator of light, and I believe that's how the Gnostics understood the Father, the Heavenly Father that Yeshua was discussing and presenting, and I think that's the case. And so then Marcion's teaching here says, or at least the Wikipedia gloss is that, according to Marcion, the God of the Greek Old Testament, the Demiurge, jealous tribal deity of the Jews, his law, that being's law, represents legalistic reciprocal justice, reward and punishment. Punishes mankind for its sins through suffering and death. And that whole association of sin is actually very legalistic. You know, sin equals breaking the rules. These are the rules. If you follow them, you're rewarded. If you break them, you're punished. And there's a great rigidity to that. Meanwhile, that's not really the way karma works. Karma is much more subtle. And karma, basically, as one great teacher, the Sri Lankan Theravadin that we looked into, kama is intention. Karma is intention. Or the nature of intention is the heart of the formation of karma that has consequence. Karma as seed and cause that leads to result. The heart of the causal basis of result in karma is intention. And that's very different than the perspective of these are rules, if you break them in any way physically, you will be punished, and if you keep them simply physically, despite whatever's going on in your mind, you'll be rewarded. So, then. This perspective, the God that Jesus professed, is an altogether different being, a universal God of compassion and love who looks upon humanity with benevolence and mercy. And that's very much in accord with Ra's understanding of the one infinite creator, whose nature is love, will, you know, the action of free will, the infinite will of the one infinite creator, or the intelligent infinity. Or infinity, its infinite will acts upon its infinite love to create light, the source of light, or the octaves, or all creation, all energy fields, the source of the energy fields that are associated with consciousness. is the creator of light, is the intelligent infinity, is infinite will acting upon infinite love. Now, when we get into the teacher of Marcion, he was considered to be a student of Cerdo. If you see in the life section, according to his anti-Marcionic Marcionite sources, his teacher was Cerdo. Now, if we look at Cerdo, the teacher of Marcion, there's a link, we see that he was a Syrian Gnostic, deemed a heretic by the church, of course, circa 138 AD, so he was, you know, a little bit, he was about the same time as Marcion, considered to be a follower of Simon Magus, and we may get into Simon Magus later, saying he taught about the same time as Valentinius and Marcion. He also taught that there were two gods, one that demanded obedience, while the other was good and merciful. The former was the God of the Old Testament, who had created the world, and again, that's not in accord with reading Ra as of the false Yahweh that co-opted the contact with Moses, being Orion. Obviously, Orion did not create anything, material, universe, or any dimension. And so they have somewhat overstated the power of Orion here. But the notion that the false god or Yahweh or the Hebrew tribal god demanded obedience while the other is good and merciful is interesting because all those on the negative path demand obedience. That's their thing. And the New World Order and those who tell you what to think demand obedience. Anybody who demands anything is suspect and probably swinging left. And so, he also, Cerdo, rejected bodily resurrection of the dead. So the later Christian notion, which seems to be, you know, commonly held by all sorts of fundamentalists, is that on the day of the return of Yeshua, the dead are going to resurrect, meaning they'll come out of their graves. This is a notion that was rejected by the Gnostics, and yet it was a notion that passed Nicaea, meaning it was accepted by the Nicaea Council, Council of Nicaea, 4th century, and became canonical that the bodily, you know, the dead will be bodily resurrected. That was a notion that the Gnostics rejected, and then they were rejected. So you can see how some of what seems to me distortions in Christian view were views held by Gnostics that were considered heretical, in the first three centuries. So the Gnostics are attractive to some spiritual, metaphysical, New Age folks, partly because their writings offer confirmation or support for certain metaphysical truths that we ourselves may hold, that come from channeled sources or Eastern metaphysics like Buddhism or Hinduism, or Advaita Vedanta and non-dualism. And so you can see that what the church came to regard as canonical and orthodox and, the right way of teaching or the true view involved a lot of rejection of a lot of other views. And so, looking further down the page on Cerdo, he basically rejected himself. He, again, taught that God preached by the law and the prophets was not the father of Jesus Christ, meaning to two different beings. The former was known, the latter unknown. And that's the notion of the alien God, or the one infinite creator, as being utterly unknowable, which is Gnostic, the Gnostic perspective. And there is something about that, true, that I would, you know, that resonates with Buddhist understanding of relative view, absolute view. Absolute view is basically that enlightenment and Nibbana cannot be described in words. It's trans-conceptual. The only thing you can say about the source of light is that it's infinite. it surely has infinite will and infinite love, and surely wishes or has wished to manifest light to make creation. But beyond those attributes of infinity, there's not that much you can say. And so it's essentially unknown and unknowable, while all that is within the octave or in time and space, in the seven-dimensional or multidimensional schema, is knowable. And so Gautama talking about, you know, awakening as freedom from naming activity. So essence is unknowable, unnameable. And all that is nameable is ultimately a differentiation of its source. And thus we have in Taoism, you know, the Tao that can be named is not the true Tao. The way that can be, the way that has a word is not the real one. So any teaching is a discussion of relative view or the differentiations of source, the manifestations of essential source in form and time and space. And so, but this kind of higher philosophy, or basically mysticism, you know, that God, the Logos is unknowable, that was too esoteric for the Church Fathers, I imagine. They wanted to form a religion and get followers and gain political power and money and influence, okay? They're not looking for truth. They're looking for politically usable philosophy, dogma, to found a church that will have power and influence and wealth and position in society and the nation, the region that they were growing. They were looking for material gain alongside the formulation of what they considered dogma. So that which was too esoteric or too subtle or too mystical surely wasn't helpful. And so this notion of two gods, we don't have to go so much further about it, but you know, if we look at some of what did pass the Council of Nicaea and became canonical, you know, we have John 8 in the Young Literal Translation, link sent to you now. John 8 begins with Jesus delivering the adulterous woman, and further down we see in John 8:44, him speaking to those that were against the adulterous woman. He says, 42, the section called the Children of the Devil. Jesus then said to them, this is the Young's literal, this is John 8:42, this is past the Nicene Council. Jesus said, if God were your father, ye were loving me, for I came forth from God and am come. For neither have I come of myself, but he sent me. Wherefore do ye not know my speech? Because ye are not able to hear my word. Ye are of a father, the devil, and the desires of your father ye will do. He was a manslayer from the beginning, and in the truth he hath not stood, because there is no truth in him. When one may speak the falsehood, of his own he speaketh, because he is a liar, also his father. And because I say the truth, ye do not believe me. Who of you doth convict me of sin? And if I speak truth, wherefore do ye not believe me? He who is of God, the sayings of God, he doth hear. Because of this, you do not hear. Because of God, you are not. So, it seems to me, he's kind of critical of the audience there. Who? They're the Jews, it seems to me. The people that he's saying unto the Jews, you know, they were there. Now, I don't care about Jews or Christians, frankly. I'm not interested in race war or religious war. But it seems like he's saying, your father's not my father. Is he a Gnostic? Well, maybe the council didn't snuff it out. They didn't snuff out Gnostic views well enough. But for him to be saying, you're not, your father is the devil, he's obviously saying that his father is not the same father as those he's speaking to. Clearly. So, in John 8:39, a little bit above. He's speaking to these folks. They answered and said to him, "Our father is Abraham," meaning they're Jewish. Jesus said to them, "If children of Abraham you were, the works of Abraham you were doing, and now you seek to kill me, a man who hath spoken to you the truth I heard from God. This Abraham did not," meaning try to kill him, "ye do the works of your father." And so that's when he says, "Your father's not my father, and Abraham has the same father, but you don't." So that sounds kind of Gnostic to me, huh? And what's also past Revelation, past the Council of Nicaea censors, Revelation 3. Revelation 3, also Young's literal translation. We have Message to the Church in Philadelphia. Okay. I'm not going to say much about this here, but this is what supposedly said by Yeshua or said by John. I guess so. Revelation 3:8. "I have known thy works. Lo, I have set before thee a door." He's speaking to what? The messenger of the assembly in Philadelphia? I don't know. "No one is able to shut it, because thou hast a little power, and didst keep my word, and didst not deny my name. Lo, I make of the synagogue of the adversary," meaning Satan or devil, "those saying themselves to be Jews, and are not, but do lie. Lo, I will make them that they may come and bow before thy feet, and may know that I love thee." So, who is this synagogue of the adversary, those saying themselves to be Jews and are not but do lie? He's basically divorcing the Jewish establishment of his time from Abraham and saying, you're not following the same tradition of Abraham. That's similar to synagogue of Satan or adversary, people saying they're Jews but are not but do lie. That passed the Council of Nicaea too. And then you have even the notion, another very deeply Gnostic notion, John 14, which is the whole notion of Yeshua, Jesus, saying that he's not that his father's greater than him, which many Gnostics were attacked as heretics for believing that he said or believed, you know, that the father of Jesus was God or higher than he. Meanwhile, here we are at John 14, also past Council of Nicaea, says, if ye 28, John 14, 28. If ye did love me, you would have rejoiced that I said, I go on to the Father, because my Father is greater than I. So that's what some Gnostics got attacked for saying, that the Father is greater than the Son. But and that passed the Bible, passed the Council of Nicaea. Why? Well, I guess the censorship wasn't far-seeing enough. So it's very complicated. So you've got Gnostic notions called heretic that seem to be embodied by some of the gospel sayings that passed the Council of Nicaea. So to say that the whole Bible is bunk or the whole New Testament is distorted, or to say it's all true, you can't say so. I mean, who knows what's true, right? We're all trying to figure it out. But we can see that there were major Gnostic teachings that were declared heretical that seem to have also been included in the canonical gospel or what passed the Council of Nicaea as Orthodox Church doctrine. So, it's a very complicated story. Now, if we look a little bit further than Cerdo, we find another Marcion was an important Gnostic. Perhaps even more important was a teacher named Valentinius. Also, the same kind of context in the Middle East. He was basically in the 2nd century, 100-160 AD, right around the time of Marcion, actually, or, you know, in that century. For a time, he was the most successful early Christian Gnostic theologian. Christian Gnostic. Oh, he was a Christian Gnostic. Aha. Uh-huh. So you can see how, you know, before Council of Nicaea, some of those called Christian were Gnostic. Or some of those who were holding Gnostic view were part of the proto or early church. Then they became heretical. Or were, you know, considered, you know, forbidden and, you know, needed to be rejected, and their texts were buried, like the Gospel of Thomas. So Valentinius, for a time the most successful early Christian Gnostic theologian, founded a school in Rome, was a candidate for the Bishop of Rome, but started his own group when another was chosen. If we go down a little bit, we see another Gnostic notion, which is very helpful. He taught that there were three kinds of people: the spiritual, the psychical, and the material. Yeah, there are levels of soul development. There are, you know, souls that'll be repeating their density. There are wanderers, and there are teachers of higher self. Wanderers, fourth, fifth, sixth density. Maybe spiritual. But there are greater beings and realms of teachers and beings beyond us, of course. So Valentinius, he was a really big guy and had a lot to say. More than Marcion, actually, taught that there were three kinds of people: the spiritual, psychical, and material. So you see, early Christianity was kind of esoteric. And he said that only those of a spiritual nature, his own followers, he said, received gnosis, which is knowledge or awakening, that allowed them to return to the divine pleroma, which is basically the heavenly realms beyond form. We can look at that, what pleroma is, and you would find some teaching that, again, would probably make sense or be supportive of or in harmony with some of the notions of Ra in terms of seven-dimensional cosmology, and Buddhism with the 31 planes and the three realms of desire, form, and formless. 31 planes in Buddhism basically divided into Kamaloka, Rupaloka, and Arupaloka. Kama meaning desire realm, Rupa meaning form, which is really, to me, fourth and fifth density. And then Arupa, no Rupa, no form, Loka realm, formless realms, sixth and seventh density. You can see a lot of fit between some of the Gnostic cosmology. Yeah, there we go. Thank you. So pleroma, from a definition, generally refers to the totality of divine powers. So what is divine powers, right? Already we see a Gnostic understanding that the Old Testament God is different than the Heavenly Father of Yeshua. One is the creator of the universe, and the other one supposes itself to be, well, you can, again, the Gnostic notions are a little bit across the board, but from Marcion and Credo and Cerdo, there seems to be the notion that the Old Testament God is the creator of some kind of material world, but is not the creator of heaven and earth or the Heavenly Father. So you see, it gets very complicated, and that's why there were many Gnostic sects, and meant today many Christian sects and Catholic groups, because they have no consistent metaphysics behind them that they can agree on. Did one being create the material universe and another being create light? It seems to me, you know, clearly, in line with Ra, the one infinite creator, or intelligent infinity, or infinity that became aware and thus intelligent infinity, the one infinite creator, the source, which is infinite power, infinite love, gave rise to light, the source of light. Light is energy. Light is the nature of energy. Ra said, the nature of energy is light, and the origin of energy is the action of free will upon love. I don't think you can go beyond that metaphysics, frankly, in terms of cosmogenesis. I think it's not possible. Meaning, you don't need more. I don't need more. Qualities of infinity pre-manifestation being infinite will and love or sentience. Sentience is love, you say. Omniscience is infinite love. So omnipotence, acting upon omniscience, infinite free will, infinite will acting upon infinite love, gives rise to omnipresence or infinite light or intelligent energy, which gives rise to the seven frequencies or the seven rays, seven dimensions of the octaves, thus sevenfold vehicles called mind-body-spirit complex, mind-body-spirit beingness totality complex, the seven-dimensional vehicle of the Logos. It's not a self, it's a vehicle. It's sevenfold energy fields that we call body, mind, spirit, beingness, higher self, totality, seventh density. That being is ultimately the vehicle of the Logos. Its identity is its source. True nature, true identity is source. I don't think you can go beyond that, frankly. I mean, you can say it in other ways, but, you know, the white light going through the prism becomes the spectrum of seven colors. Yes, the Pink Floyd album is correct. And so, by triadism, infinity generates white light that then becomes a septenate or an octave or the rainbow of seven rays and the octaves, seven dimensions. And the sevenfold energy structure of the octave self, or the vehicle of the Logos in the octave, mind, body, spirit, being as totality complex, the seven chakra, seven dimensional energy consciousness vehicle of the Logos, or beingness that appears to evolve through time and space. Now, I don't think you can get beyond that philosophy, frankly. You can say it in other ways, but I don't think that, I think that you can't boil it down beyond that, really. I don't see any kind of boiling down, meaning I think those are core concepts. You can't experience it with concept, but in terms of distilled philosophy of cosmogenesis, I don't think you can go beyond that, frankly. Go beyond meaning explain the process by which light is established or light is fashioned from that which is beyond light. From the creative process that gives rise to light, which is energy, which is matter, which is planets and stars and galaxies, all of that multidimensional creation came to be by primal principles, the interplay of principles, which principles? Will and love, you know, the action of free will upon love. Omnipotent will acts upon omniscient love and gives rise to omnipresent light that differentiates into the seven rays and the octaves and all energy fields and all matter and all consciousness associated with it. I don't think you can boil concepts down, cosmological concepts, cosmogenesis concepts. I don't think you can boil it down beyond that, because we don't need to complicate it, but I think this explains it quite perfectly. So when we say Valentinius, my dear friend, saying that there were three kinds of people in the spiritual, are those that can receive gnosis, meaning knowledge, allowing them to return to the divine pleroma. What divine pleroma are we talking about? Well, there's what he meant. There's what the readers of Valentinius think he meant. They're the followers who have different views of what he meant. And then there's how I or you may interpret what he meant based on your own metaphysics. So based on my metaphysics of cosmogenesis or cosmology, you know, when one opens to real gnosis, one is qualified to leave the octave. One returns to the heart of the logos, you know. As Nityananda says, Atman or Jivatman becomes one with Paramatman. The sub-sub-logos returns to sub-logos, according to Ra. Same. That's self-realization. That's the ending of avidya. That's the return to Nibbana. That's the blowing out of the flame in Buddhism. Same. But that doesn't mean that's what Valentinius said meant. Who knows what he meant? But then you have another level. So there's the spiritual level of beings, and then you have those of the second level, the psychic nature, which he called ordinary Christians, attaining a lesser form of salvation. You could say, what, harvestability? But again, what did he mean? We don't really know. The academics don't necessarily know. The followers didn't necessarily know. Who knows if he knew? I mean, you know, there are teachers who are crazy. I don't think he is, but there are teachers who don't deeply understand what they're saying. Damn sure there are. Ask them, question them closely and see how well they can explain what they mean. Sometimes they can't. Then those of the material nature, pagans and Jews. Ah, so you see the Gnostic, we're doomed to perish, whatever that means, right? Even you go to hell. Christian notion, you go to hell, you sin, or whatever, go to hell. In Buddhism, is accepted. Yeah, okay, you know, you do unvirtuous or unskillful action of a certain nature, you acquire a certain karmic liability, and yes, yeah, you may well go to hell, which is basically a lower level in Kamaloka, or, you know, in a more, I think, more sophisticated metaphysics, would be a lower astral plane, 3D time space. That works for me. Is it ruled over by the Archons? Well, you can say that, but, you know, we don't need, we don't, we should boil down poetic terms into durable metaphysics. And like Ra's talking about ego. Ra said, we find this concept unworkable, and understanding cannot come from it. So I don't use the word ego, and I chafe when somebody uses it, because, you know, the existence of a sense of self is no basis for imputation of a thing called ego. There is a sense of self. That doesn't mean there's a thing called ego. And so, be careful, you know, lots of teachers use, you know, what Buddhism calls putting a head on your head. What I would call putting a frame in empty space. Don't complicate yourself. Don't complicate yourself. Anyway, but it is interesting that Valentinius certainly could not become a bishop of Rome saying that the pagans and the Jews were doomed to perish. Now, again, Buddhism understands, yeah, there is a hell realm. Yeah. Ra talks about the lower astral too. But it's not forever. But it's real. It's as real as Howard Storm had it. It's as real as your life right now. I assure you. So then, Valentinius is a big guy, okay? He's bigger than Marcion in my book. Big meaning a deeper thinker. So, interestingly, we go down a bit to the biography of Valentinius, and we find that Clement of Alexandria records that his followers of Valentinius said that Valentinius was a follower of Theudas, Theudas, and that Theudas, in turn, was a follower of St. Paul the Apostle. And there's not much on Theudas, but Valentinius is said to have said that Theudas imparted to him the secret wisdom that Paul had taught privately to his inner circle, which Paul publicly referred to in connection with his visionary encounter with the risen Christ, when he received the secret teaching from him. So, aha! We have what even old Wikipedia calls esoteric teachings. These esoteric teachings that began, I guess, with Paul the Apostle, who then said that he had a visionary encounter with the risen Christ, meaning on the road to Damascus, I guess. You know, I'm not a scholar, so I make mistakes here. So please, I apologize in advance for being not an excellent scholar of proto-Christian history and ideology. But I think, I guess, Paul meets, the risen Jesus Christ on the road to Damascus. That doesn't mean that happened, but maybe something happened. So here you have a hardcore Gnostic, and an important one, Valentinius, saying that he got his teachings ultimately from his teacher, who then was taught by Paul, who imparted to Theudas that which he got from a manifestation of Yeshua, or Christ, on the road to Damascus. And then, of course, we see such esoteric teachings were downplayed in Rome after the mid-second century. I wonder why. And so, you see, ideological control. Control of dogma. Doctrinal control. Control by the Orthodox authorities over what doctrine will be accepted and what rejected, so as to build a big social organization and gain power. And you see, you know, this all led to the Vatican, right? To the, you know, the Holy Roman Church. And all of that. Based on what? Based on a whole lot of wrangling and a whole lot of rejection of doctrines that they felt not going to be, not compatible with what they were trying to build. What were they trying to build? So, but the Gnostics, in many ways, represent groups of proto-Christians or Near East folks, some of whom were even called Christians at the time, or were intimately associated with Christians at the time, or they were Christians, but they held notions that later became heretical. Meanwhile, some of those notions passed the Council of Nicaea, and we see it in the Book of Revelation or the Gospel of John and other books. That's interesting. So, he was expected, Valentinius, to become a bishop, but another guy didn't get it. He broke with the church. Interestingly, further down, it shows, while Valentinius was alive, he made many disciples. So these groups were competing for money and people and sponsorship. While Valentinius was alive, and it's said that he died around 160 or 161, he made many disciples. His system was the most widely diffused of all forms of Gnosticism. Okay? He's a big guy. Although, as Tertullian remarked, it developed, of course, into several different versions, not all of which acknowledged their dependence on him. Say he, Tertullian, I guess, wrote, they affect to disavow their name. So you see, you know, students reject their teachers and then take portions of their teachers' teachings and then claim them as their own. So honest, these humans. And groups consider yesterday's teaching that was doctrinal is today's heresy that's rejected. And today's teaching may even echo what we now have declared heretical, because somebody didn't get around to excising it and cutting it out of what's now called canonical. So it's a lying group of souls on this planet. So they're just a bunch of liars. Nobody is loyal to their teacher. Nobody is even giving credit. Why don't we give credit? Huh? There's such a lack of gratitude. Anyway, Ptolemy was considered a Valentinian. That's interesting. So, I mean, again, I'm no scholar here, but some of these guys are important. And you can see that the early Gnostics in the first three centuries had a whole lot of influence on a whole lot of people. And that's probably one reason that their views were declared heretical and they had to be buried in what became the Nag Hammadi Library, where we find the Gospel of Thomas. So there is also something here called the Gospel of Truth, which was discovered at Nag Hammadi. And so this gospel of truth, according to Irenaeus, was the same as the gospel of Valentinius. In his book, mentioned by Tertullian in his book Against All Heresies, meaning against everybody who might compete with us and take followers. So, the gospel of truth is related to the gospel of Valentinius, is a Coptic version of this gospel of truth was found at Nag Hammadi. Was that related to Valentinius? Perhaps. And so, further down, we'll look at this in a moment, the gospel of truth. Christian heresiologists, meaning those that focused on attacking heresy, that's their job. Today they work for the intelligence agencies. The heresiologists wrote details about the life of Valentinius, often scurrilous, meaning false and libelous, or false and derogatory, meaning they're liars. Is that surprising? Nope. As mentioned above, Tertullian claimed... Tertullian, you know, he's got a good name, but I don't know if he was a scurrilous writer, too. Tertullian claimed that Valentinius was a candidate for bishop, we saw that already, after which he turned to heresy in a fit of pique. More likely, Valentinius had certain views that would not have supported the building of the political machine of the proto-church into doctrine, dogma that would be effective in establishing their power in the political situation of those nations. You know, if the teaching is too esoteric, people will get turned off, or people will get into trouble. And so, who knows what the truth is? Epiphanius wrote that Valentinius gave up the true faith after he had suffered a shipwreck in Cyprus and became insane. These descriptions can be reconciled and are not impossible, but few scholars cite these accounts as other than rhetorical insults. So the guys that brought you canonical doctrine, the gospel of the canons doctrinally true, are those that made rhetorical insults and wrote deceptive lies against their enemies. So how honest are such writers? So when we get into the cosmology, I'm not sure how far to go here, but I don't want to go into another week on Valentinius, but we can see that there was a lot of fighting going on. Further down, Valentinianism is the name of the school of Gnostic philosophy dating back to Valentinius, one of the major Gnostic movements, widespread following throughout the Roman Empire, and provoking voluminous writings by Christian heresiologists. I wonder why. Maybe because he was insane? Or was he a political economic threat? Valentinius again professed to have derived his ideas from Theudas, disciple of St. Paul. And unlike a great number of other Gnostic systems, which are expressly dualist, Valentinius developed a system that was more monist, expressed in dualistic terms. And I don't want to get into his cosmology because I have a better one from the raw material, in my view. Find your truth, you know? I like my view. I hope you like your view, too. And I'm open to reformed view or deeper understanding. But I don't think that it's necessary to listen to everybody if you don't have time or if you don't want to. If you think you know better, or you've got a view that seems to be quite correct, you know? So, anyway, Valentinian cosmology is very complicated. He attempted, interestingly, to align Christianity with Platonism, which was very mystical, drawing dualistic conceptions from the Platonic world of ideal forms, the Pleroma, meaning what? For density, fit density? Who knows? Who knows what they know? I don't think their view was that sophisticated in terms of a seven-dimensional system, and then versus the lower world of phenomena. So he was in some ways, you know, a Platonist, which is interesting. And then it goes on saying that of the mid-second century thinkers, you know, around the time of Valentinius, and preachers who were declared heretical by Irenaeus and other mainstream Christians, the church fathers who were on full-on attack mode, only Marcion of Sinope, as we've said, is outstanding as a personality. And the contemporary Orthodox counter to Valentinius was Justin Martyr. So, Valentinius and Marcion on the one hand, and Justin Martyr, or the different church fathers of the second century, on the other, it was a very rich intellectual, philosophical, metaphysical discussion time, very much like the 6th century in Greece or China. So it was, there was a lot going on in the few centuries after Yeshua passed or made the transition. So I don't want to go more into his cosmology. At the bottom of the page, we can look at a little bit. Gospel of Truth, again, was discovered at Nag Hammadi. It may well be a text from Valentinius. And it says, it is a declaration of the unknown name of Jesus' divine Father, the possession of which of an unknown name, enables the knower to penetrate the veil of ignorance that has separated all created beings from said Father, from the Heavenly Father. Meaning, the name, you know, this is getting into magic, actually. And some of these guys were very magical, like Simon Magus, meaning they were white or black magicians. But, so this Gospel of Truth includes the notion or a declaration that the unknown name of Yeshua's real Heavenly Father, or the Heavenly Father of Yeshua, the real Creator, that unknown name, if in one's possession, or one knows that name, that knower may gain gnosis, penetrate the veil of ignorance, right? Ignorance, avidya, separating all created beings from the Father, separating creation from its source, which again suggests moving out of the octave. But again, how deeply, how sophisticated they thought out what they were saying is hard to know. You know, a lot of people talk about a higher self; they have some vague notion of what it is. They can't explain it very well. Is it the same as what I'm saying? Well, I can say it is, and maybe if I say what I think, or, you know, give Ra's explanation of higher self, they'll agree. But that isn't quite what they meant. Or is it what they meant? They're not sure what they mean. If you don't know what you're saying or what you believe deeply, you don't know what you're pointing towards. You have to know what you say. You have to know deeply what you think you know if you really want to explain it well. But, I mean, you can do anything you want, but if you want to know, you must know deeply. If you cannot say, it's probably because you don't know deeply. I mean, you know, if you want to know deeply, learn to teach. Start teaching. Speak, give yourself a platform to teach. If you want to clarify your mind, put out the call for those who might want you to teach or help. And if they don't bother them. But if they come and ask questions, learn to teach. And learn to teach, you'll find that you don't actually know as well as you thought you knew. Because if you can't say, it's probably because you don't know. Or if you don't know deeply, you don't really know. And it's also possible to be seeking more deeply than any teacher's teaching. Meaning, some teacher gives a teaching, or some person gives a teaching, and they can't explain it so deeply because they don't really know. Or they know only to some degree. Me too. We all know only to some degree. And it's all conceptual. It's all illusion. Yeah. It's all relative view. True. But, you know, like this teaching from the Gospel of Truth, the possessing the unknown name of Yeshua's Heavenly Father enables the Gnostic, the knower, to go beyond the veil of ignorance that separates creation from its source, meaning separating created beings from said Father. Does that mean that they were teaching that which will lead to freedom from rebirth in the octave? Not necessarily, but the metaphysics seems right, that at least the notion that all created beings come from the source of light. The creative source gives rise to light, and all beings are created. There is no God but God, like the Islamic Shahada, I think, or something. There's no God but God is very Gnostic, which is the same as what Yeshua seemed to be saying, that the Heavenly Father I'm talking about isn't the same as the one that you follow in your desire to kill me. In your desire to kill me, saying that you're the you're following Abraham's father, he said to the Jews, your father is not this father, or your father is not even Abraham's father. But the father that he's talking about is that which is the source of creation. Now, in the raw material, that would be the original, you know, Rod actually didn't even say that the original Yahweh in touch with Moses was the infinite creator. So that, you know, people are, you know, it's mistake upon mistake. Even the original Yahweh, according to the raw material in touch with Moses before the Orion co-optation of the name, the wrong name, wasn't the Heavenly Father or one infinite creator that gave rise to light or created beings, but just Confederation Yahweh group. So, who can you talk to about these things? Very few. And furthermore, from the Gospel of Truth, we see that it declares, the Gospel of Truth, maybe from Valentinius, that Jesus has revealed that name through a variety of modes laden with a language of abstract elements. How about a convoluted way of saying it? How about we say, the Gospel of Truth stated or declared that Jesus did reveal his name through symbolic language and coded speech. He revealed the name in many ways, in coded symbolic ways. Maybe so. Then we go to the Gospel of Truth, although we don't have time here, but you can see the link. This is something we can look at next time too. The Gospel of Truth, one of the Nag Hammadi texts in Coptic, two Coptic translations, and it was in the Jung Codex. Dear Carl Jung got into the Gospel of Truth. He was a Gnostic, you're damn right. And appreciated Valentinius. Yes, sir. And some people say that the Gospel of Truth was written by Valentinius himself. How about that? So, we don't know. But that'll be it for today. Next time, maybe, we'll look at the Gospel of Truth from Valentinius himself, or the Valentinian Gnostics, or other Gnostics. There's not so much to say about it, but it is interesting, and Carl Jung had a lot to say, or appreciated it, it seems. And we're working our way to the Gospel of Thomas. I hope this has been useful. I think after we get through the Gospel of Truth, we may or may not look at Simon Magus, but we're getting closer to the Gospel of Thomas, and then comparing the Oxyrhynchus Greek fragments 20 to the total of 114 Coptic Nag Hammadi Gospel of Thomas document fragments. So that'll take us a long time. First, we'll do that comparison of the Greek to the Coptic, and tease out, you know, whatever I think, whatever it seems he was saying. God knows what they were saying. I'm not sure they always know, and teachers don't always know what they're saying. But it is true, you know, if you can't explain it deeply, you may well not know it. If you can't explain it deeply, do you really know it? And I'm not trying to say that I'm better than anybody, but I've surely learned that, the test of comprehension is articulation. And a clear mind is really helpful. It's a beautiful thing. As much as I can enjoy a clear mind, I can say that it's a wonderful thing to continue developing. And mind is the revealer, sang the Hindus. It's the slayer of the real, but it's the revealer. And so, mind is not the self. Mind is a vehicle. Mind is a tool. Yet, it is the basis of revelation. So, mind is apocalypse. The apocalypse is the mind complex. The mind complex is apocalyptic. It's revelatory. It reveals that which is beyond itself. The mind complex reveals spirit. And spirit reveals its source. And its source is our true nature and destination. So, thank you very much. Thank you, Nepartak, coming close. We'll see how we are. Thanks again, take good care, and good night.